issues, but these are very contemporary issues that need to be addressed, I think, every year for our police department. And for those people who don't know, I think it's important to note that we are an internationally accredited law enforcement agency, and we just received our 7th reaccreditation this spring. And some of you may know that law enforcement agencies who achieve accreditation, and it's very hard to do this, are considered really the gold standard for demonstrating that they meet established standards that define performance policy and procedures. We're subject to an independent on-site inspection, ongoing random reviews of our policy and procedure, and we have to provide proofs of compliance on an ongoing basis. It really is a tough process, but we believe it's important that our citizens deserve it, and they really deserve the best that we can be. Now, this is a biggie, our use of force policy. This is critical to our accreditation and our ongoing training. We do not teach choke codes and tactics, and they are prohibited by policy. We do require de-escalation techniques training, and that's in our policy. Officers have to identify themselves and give warning before they use deadly force. Franklin Police policy and training states that all other means will be used prior to deadly force if possible. Therefore, we do have a force continuum. Officers have a duty to intervene. Our policy requires comprehensive reporting for any use of force. And here's something I think is very important. An officer can use only deadly force in defense of human life, and that includes the officer's life. Now, some of you may or may not know that we have an early warning system. The system is designed to alert supervisory personnel of any potential trends or patterns that need to be reviewed by our employee performance, by our supervisors. Now, this hopefully will indicate if there's something going wrong with this employee. It includes excessive sick leave, tardiness, any inappropriate behavior, a decline in their job performance, an increase in citizen complaints to vehicle crashes, and here's an important one, any use of force. These alerts are received and reviewed through the chain of command, and appropriate action is taken, which could include training or retraining, counseling. They may be advised to use our EAP, our employee assistance, or it could also come to disciplinary action. I also want to mention our bias-based profiling annual report. The use of bias-based policing is strictly prohibited in all contacts with the public. Officers have to provide information on each traffic stop, arrest, field interviews, and so on, any interaction with the public. This documentation is reviewed each year, and we determine whether or not there's any patterns to these activities that are negative. Any officer who observes or has information about the use of bias-based profiling by any member of the department shall immediately notify their immediate supervisor or highest ranking authority, and action is taken immediately. Now, body cameras is another hot topic. Franklin police officers have had body cameras for over 2 years now, and they're required to have them turned on whenever they're responding to a call for service. Franklin police vehicles have been equipped with dash cameras now for almost 20 years, so we're no strangers to having cameras around. Now, I'll close because I know you have a long agenda, but what I've just provided is really just a snapshot of some of the important steps that we take to uphold our law enforcement code of ethics and our oath of office. Members of the Franklin Police Department work hard to provide quality police services to the people that we serve here in Franklin. We select our officers carefully. We screen them thoroughly. We train them constantly. And we constantly review model policies from professional organizations like the ISCP, the TACP, our accrediting agency, which is the Commission on Law Enforcement Accreditation, and any and all 21st century policing best practices. Every one of my officers are proud to serve this city, and I'm proud to be their chief. They've each taken an oath to protect everyone, even at the risk of losing their own life. And we are committed to our community, and we'll continue to work hard to earn your trust. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Chief, for your thorough covering of the training and the professionalism of our police. We thank you very much. Are there any other citizen comments tonight, Mr. Stuckey?
Any citizen comments on the phone line? Nothing, Mr. Mayor.
We'll move on to item two, which is a resolution authorizing the mayor to execute certain documents relating to a refinancing of debt for the Battleground Academy through the City of Franklin Health and Education Board facilities.
Mr. Mayor, this is an item that comes through our Health and Education Board. It is no recourse debt refunding that is coming.
Battleground Academy. So I'll have Christine Brock talk a little bit about that. Christine.
Thank you, Eric. On June the 5th, 2020, the Health and Educational Facilities Board met and approved a bond resolution to refinance debt that was borrowed by Battleground Academy. This debt, as Eric just stated, is the sole obligation of the borrower, and the lender has no recourse to the city in any form or fashion. This item is before you only because federal tax law requires the local government to acknowledge that a public hearing and a public meeting was held. It also, the document that the mayor would be requested to sign acknowledges that the city has no responsibility for the debt, and also that the meeting was held in accordance to public notice requirements. And that's in essence what the resolution is asking this board to give authorization to Mayor Moore to sign on its behalf.
Any questions or comments from the board? Hearing none, we'll move on to item three. And I believe we'll consider items three and four together, if that's okay, which is an ordinance 2020-10 to rezone 21.24 acres from regional commerce and general office to planned district for the property located south of Oak Meadow Drive and east of South Royal Oaks Boulevard, the Vintage at Watson Glen PUD subdivision, and item four is the development plan. Who's gonna speak to that?
I can speak to that. Sorry, it took me a second to unmute.
Find that button.
I know, like the arrow wouldn't go there. The applicant is requesting to rezone the property from regional commercial and general office to a planned district that would have the entitlements of 11.35 for residential and 12,320 square feet of commercial. This would accommodate a proposed development plan for the Vintage at Watson Glen, and the development plan has been submitted concurrently. Envision Franklin places this property in the neighborhood mixed-use design concept. The planned development district is an appropriate base zone for this design concept, and I am assuming, though I can't see him, that the applicant is here to talk about his project. Maybe.
Yes, I'm here. Hi, this is Greg Gamble.
Yeah, Greg had sent me an email asking to speak on the issue, and he said he would need about 5 minutes. So
maybe less.
maybe less.
I'll go quick. Am I able to share my screen?
Yes, for me.
Great. Thank you for giving us this opportunity tonight through the Zoom meeting. We greatly appreciate this format during this time, and enables us to continue to move forward with our proposal. The proposed plan is a joint venture between Bob Goodall, Warner Bass, and TDK, and is one of the last phases of the Watson Glen subdivision, which has started in late 1990s. I'm joined on the call tonight with by Ross Bradley with TDK, Caleb Thorne and Brandon Baxter with Reagan Smith. So there are two remaining properties that are undeveloped in the Watson Glen subdivision, and they're highlighted here on the screen. The property that is along I-65, we're planning to leave it as Regional Commerce 6, which is shown here in purple. The property identified here as Vintage at Watson Glen is currently in RC6, and we're proposing a rezoning to PD district planned, the planned district. Envision Franklin identifies this area as neighborhood mixed use and as a transition area between regional commerce policy to the north and single family policy to the south. The proposed master plan is a mixed use development complementary to the existing development along Oak Meadow and Royal Oaks. The area located along I-65 is not included in this request, but I will point out that we did submit the Riverside Drive extension for review on Monday to city staff, and anticipate that moving forward for construction. This would connect the Riverside Drive cul-de-sac to Oak Meadow Drive. The the proposed planned district portion is a planned with a one-story restaurants totaling 7,900 square feet at the intersection of Royal Oaks and Oak Meadow. We're keeping the one-story relationship with the other buildings that are also at this intersection. The restaurants are bordered by a tributary that flows into Watson's Branch and provides a natural edge and screening for the parking area located behind the restaurants. We plan to cross the tributary with a pedestrian bridge here that will connect the residential amenity area to the outdoor dining of the restaurants on the corner, and will connect the parking areas of the restaurant to the mixed use parking for the vehicular circulation. Summerby is predominantly a four-story building, and the proposed three-story buildings across Oak Meadow will transition the building height to the south. The parking areas are located behind the building and are screened from view by the buildings and the preservation of the existing trees within the proposed 10-acre park along Watson's Branch. So this is the front elevations of the homes. You'll see here the commercial ground floor with residential above. The 10.6-acre park is proposed to be privately maintained, but will be open to the public and will have public access easement over the park. We plan to reinvest some of the parkland dedication fee into the construction of the park amenities. Comments have been made about providing parking closer to the park, and we believe that we can accommodate that within the parking area and the parking lot. We have reduced the total number of multifamily apartments to 241 and have approximately 9,500 square feet of non-residential on the ground level. The first three buildings closest to Royal Oaks are planned with active first floors, including office, fitness, and the residence club. The office areas and the mixed use buildings are not specifically designated for residents. They are office spaces that may be leased by any small business. Residences located on the ground floor will have stoops and porches with direct access out to Oak Meadow. The sidewalks are interconnected throughout the master plan and will provide pedestrian connections to the new park, as well as to the commercial businesses to the north. With all of this, though, we understand that this development will have an impact on traffic flow on Royal Oaks and Murfreesboro Road. As presented at the joint conceptual workshop, the arterial road impact fees estimated at $850,000 are proposed to be used to improve the intersections of Royal Oaks and address the signal timing on Murfreesboro Road. So those are the areas that are shown here in blue. And of course, the intersections that are at I-65 and at Oak Meadow and Highway 96. We will add a third right turn lane from Royal Oaks to Murfreesboro Road, and we'll extend the right turn lanes to a length of 1,200 feet. The intersections of Rand Place and Riverside Drive are failing intersections today. Our proposal includes removing the median cut at Rand Place and providing a left in only at Riverside Drive. These improvements will result in a level of service B at these intersections. All of these improvements will be constructed with this proposal, with this multifamily and mixed use development proposal that we're showing you here today, identified as the Vintage at Watson's Glen. The portion of property that we are keeping as Regional Commerce 6, the base zone, would be responsible for those areas that are shown here in green. The safety consideration to add a median on Murfreesboro Road will require more conversation and study. The improvement, if approved by the board and mayor and aldermen, will be associated with the future development of office along I-65 behind the Home Depot. I will point out that the previous proposal for apartments on this property had a traffic report that did not propose road improvements and noted that the roadways were sufficient to accept additional traffic, and this is simply not the case. Our proposal is an excellent example of how development can make improvements for growth, leaving roads better in the future than they are now. We have held 8 neighborhood meetings with several hundred residents and business owners. It has been stressed to us that the number one concern is mitigating the traffic on Royal Oaks. Reagan Smith did traffic counts prior to the COVID pandemic and while school was in session. They submitted their findings of the traffic study and it has been reviewed by the city, by Adam Mosier, and Greg Judy with Neil Schaefer. They have all concurred that the improvements specified are mitigating not only this PUD, but also the additional 195,000 square feet of commercial planned behind Home Depot, in addition to 5 years of normal city growth. So our study was projected ahead to 2024. And then the additional development intensities were applied at that date. Without these improvements, the intersections from the property to I-65 will continue to dwindle in their level of service. We have also heard through these meetings the appreciation that many of the neighbors have had in the investment of new development on the Royal Oaks corridor. Much of the corridor was constructed toward the end of the 90s and several buildings currently without tenants. Vintage of Watson Glen hopefully will inspire additional reinvestment in this area. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. Now is an opportunity for the board to make some comments. I'll just go down the list. And Alderman Barnhill, do you have any comments?
No.
Alderman Martin.
Yes.
Go ahead.
I think we sort of have short memories. 2 years ago, we beat this issue to a pulp. We heard from 98% or more of the residents in the area. And I thought we had decided that it should remain commercial rather than residential. So I'm just wondering what has changed about the property that makes it now suitable for this type of development instead of commercial.
This is Greg Gamble, and I'm happy to speak to that. The previously submitted plan for this site was 100% multifamily apartments, and our proposal includes a mix of uses. We've heard from the residents through our neighborhood meetings that they're excited about having some additional restaurant opportunities. Also, the previous proposal did not propose road improvements to Royal Oaks or to 96 out to I-65. our improvements do make significant impacts to the traffic pattern and the traffic volumes along these two roadways.
I'd also like to jump in just to kind of reiterate what Greg said. The previous proposal included all multifamily, not only on this parcel that we're talking about, but also that parcel behind Home Depot adjacent to the interstate, mm-hmm. which resulted in a much larger number of units being proposed. Also, since that time, Envision Franklin was amended to recommend neighborhood mixed use as the design concept here. That was requested by the property owner last year, and that was amended by the Planning Commission.
Thank you.
Alderman Bransford.
I like the mixed concept. But Greg, remind me again, we are at a failing at the intersection, but with the road improvements, that will give us some improvements. Are there any years attached to that, or is there any longevity? How long will the improvements that you're proposing part of this development with that improvement with the roads, how long will that last? Because if we at pretty much 90% failing now, how much will that add to us?
And I do have the data here available that we can I can show you from the work session that shows the levels of scores of the intersection, if that's helpful. Inevitably, the I-65 interchange will need to be improved.
Okay. So this will give us some relief, but not all the relief we would need to make this a functioning area with that major development.
If you'd like, I could be more specific and share my screen just for a few minutes. Would that be helpful?
Because that is the concern that I hear is, you know, related to the traffic. Like I said, I like the mixed use idea. People do want restaurants and other things in their area, in their neighborhood, particularly when they can walk to them. But in the same time, it will cause traffic to be something that is of concern. I just wanted to have it on the record that this was discussed at this level.
And what we evaluated was the existing traffic scores of these intersections. And you see here, these on the far left column that range from, we'll pick Highway 65 in Royal Oaks, which is a level of service D. And that's today. We looked ahead to 5 years from now when there's just normal growth. This is without our proposed development. It's a level of service D with a delay of 43.1 seconds. With the improvements, it's still a level of service D, but we lowered the delay to 36.8. So our improvements are able to come in and make the situation better than if we just didn't develop the development. So that's one example. This is the next slide down. This is where we see the failing intersection at I-65. And you see here today that it's a level of service with a delay of 75.1 seconds. In the future, without our development, it's still an F, it's a delay of 92 seconds. But with the improvements we're able to make, we're able to get it back down close to an 80 second delay, even with the development that's being proposed. And this analysis that was done included the mixed use on Royal Oaks and 195,000 square feet of commercial along I-65.
Great. I just don't want the public thinking that these road improvements are going to solve that, solve everything.
Ultimately, there needs to be improvements by the state at the I-65 interchange.
Thank you.
Alderman Speedy, any comments?
Sure, I think I've been at all eight of those neighborhood meetings, and what Greg has said is the number one concern is definitely the traffic. So I do think with these specific, road improvements, not just paying into the road impact fees, it's clear that this is going to benefit that whole corridor. I drive it every single day. And he's right. It's probably been 20 plus years since a lot of those commercial areas have been developed. There are a lot of vacant areas, so I'm kind of excited about another restaurant. I also think having Riverside be connected will just improve the connectivity in that area. We haven't mentioned it today, but there is sufficient school capacity for that multifamily development there. You know, some people have talked about keeping it as a green space. It's not a usable green space right now. So I'm happy that he's been able to meet with a lot of the neighbors, all the HOA presidents, and really get a lot of input on this. And so I'll be supporting it.
I'd like to add too that these improvements will be done prior to the certificate of occupancy of the buildings. So they're tied to this first phase.
Go ahead, Alderman Berger.
Good. That's good to hear, Greg. Such a much better development than the one that came before us last time with just 100% apartments, which I totally did not like. This is much better designed and mixed use. And I think it's going to serve all the area there well. I think you're doing quite a bit to mitigate the traffic and work with the road system there. And one thing I do like is that you're funneling people down to come out on Royal Oaks at the lights. And you are putting up another light, correct? Are you putting up another light at that inner?
There's a turn lane will be added. But the lights will be at Royal Oaks, Riverside Drive, and Oak Meadow Drive where they are today.
Yes, okay. That's going to help a lot on that traffic, safely getting them on and off of Royal Oaks. And the last thing is 96, that is a huge challenge up there. That is something we're going to address. I know your clients are paying a number of high dollars into road impact fees that we can use in that area. But that challenge is going to be us working with the state and trying to come to some conclusion of what to do with that area between Royal Oaks and the interstate, and trying to get the state to do another exchange up there, probably a diamond that we desperately need in that area. So that's for another day and another discussion, but at least we have, how much impact fees? We have about 900,000 on that.
Yes, so 950,000 estimated for improvements between Royal Oaks and I-65.
I want to make sure we use those monies wisely and work with the state at some point here in the near future. Thank you.
Alderman Peterson. Any comments?
Okay, yeah. Yes, I just had to unmute. I did attend some of the local meetings, the neighborhood meetings where this was discussed. Obviously, traffic is a large problem here. However, looking at what would work with the improvements that are proposed would make a difference. I did have one very small question about this. Do I recall that this has parking on the street?
Yes, we are proposing parking on the street, and currently the Oak Meadow Drive has a speed limit that varies. We would like to request that the speed limit, and I'm not sure if that is, it's not a part of this voting cycle, but request that the speed limit of Oak Meadow Drive be consistent, 25 miles an hour from Royal Oaks all the way through the residential neighborhood, and not vary in speed limit. But that's a request we'd like to bring to you in the near future.
Well, I'm not very happy about parking on the street, even if it's 25 miles an hour, because there is a great deal of traffic on there, as many people have stated. And to also go back, you're saying that there will be the connection to Riverside that I guess would give people another opportunity to ride there.
It does provide additional connectivity, and the on-street parking that's on Oak Meadow is really directly across from Summerbee to provide on-street mm-hmm. parking for the ground floor office uses.
Thank you.
Vice Mayor?
Yes. Greg, would you pull up the screen that shows the road improvements to be made? that one. Did I understand you correctly to say that the improvements in green would only be made when and if what is shown as commercial development was approved? Greg, you're going to have to unmute.
There we go. Riverside Drive was submitted yesterday, and we're planning on moving ahead with its construction. It is not reimbursable from the arterial road impact fees. The Riverside Drive.
I'm more worried about the fact that 96 is shown in the green to be, which as I understood it was to be done later.
It is to be done later. It's going to have much further discussion. What we know is that we're projecting that commercial development to generate about $900,000 in arterial road impact fees. That could be used for those improvements, but it's not on the table for a yes or no vote with the mixed use development we're proposing.
And that is my concern, that we would wind up with how many residential units and how many square feet of retail before anything was done to improve 96?
The improvements to 96 are at the traffic signals that increase the volume and the ability and the also the turn lanes that are turning from Royal Oaks onto 96. The median is what's going to take more discussion.
Yes, I've understood that so far. My point is about the timing. You're planning to put a significant number of residential units and a significant amount of square footage here on Oak Meadow as part of the proposal that you are presenting now, but you are not planning to do the significant and necessary improvements to 96 unless and until your commercial development on Riverside Drive is approved and under construction.
Correct, but the improvements that are shown here in blue are the capacity improvements. The median is a safety consideration.
I'd like to echo what Greg said is the major capacity improvements are being made with this first phase, and the median down 96 is exactly what he stated is that's for safety purposes only. And we are getting the majority of the capacity issues resolved with this first phase of development.
Well, that's some relief, but some of us might say that the safety is at least as important, if not more important, than the capacity.
The other thing I'd state is, as Greg stated, they submitted the development or a preliminary plat for that Riverside Drive. We are pairing that plat with a additional road impact fee offset agreement that would be then recorded against the property to require them to make those improvements before those commercial properties move forward in any way, shape, or form. And so that's work under progress, and they're actively moving forward with it.
Thank you.
I've got Alderman Speedy wants to ask another question, then Alderman Berger.
And this may be for Paul and Greg. I know we also talked a lot about the Royal Oaks and Mac Hatcher intersection. And I guess it was kind of agreed that that would not be improved at this point in time because of TDOT widening the southeast part of Mac Hatcher to four lanes.
Greg's more than welcome to chime in, but in the past we've studied that with TDOT to be able to make those capacity improvements. And due to the rock walls and the bluffs, it kind of snowballed into being an extremely expensive product or project. And ultimately what TDOT recommended was to wait until the bigger improvements happened with the south corridor, southeast section of Mac Hatcher. And so we know it's TDOT's actively working on it. We don't have a time frame set. We know the level of service is not good during those peak hours, but TDOT is working on it. And I want to say it became a multi-million dollar project to be able to undertake that and meet TDOT's requirements. And Greg, you're welcome to chime in if you've heard something different.
No, it's the same.
Alderman Berger.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, this whole deal with 96, that's going to take some time. Greg, how long is this development process? How many years is this project?
the first one and the second one?
Sure. We have about 8 more months until we would have a grading permit if we followed a normal path to construction. And we have about 1.5 years worth of construction. So at the minimum, 2 years before the door is open.
Okay. Well, I know, Paul, you and I have spoken extensively about this. We've had some meetings about it. Alderman Speedy and I, we shared this road for our wards, and we've been in some meetings with this, which y'all have held on Zoom recently, the last couple months. And, you know, we really need to start working towards that solution. Yeah, we've got capacity up there, got a plenty of capacity. What do we have? 6 lanes across that plus turn lane? I don't know. It's like a interstate up there. We've got a lot of capacity, but we have a lot of issues with safety. But we do have some redevelopment coming in that area, hopefully sooner than later. If we can get our ducks in order to help that development materialize. But the bank building and the Shoney's old building are set for redevelopment, hopefully. So once that goes, we can get some road impact fees there that I hope that we will then add to that $900,000 for 96. Then maybe, Paul, maybe we can have that discussion with TDOT. You know, granted, we've had a big setback here this year financially for the state and all of us, but I think we ought to really take a look at how we can move this project along with, I think TDOT mentioned the diamond at the intersection, the I-65 intersection at 96 there. So I want to get this right. I don't want to rush this. I don't want it. You know, and I don't think there's any possibility of rushing it considering our finances with the state and everything, but I think it is a possibility to move this thing along. And I'm not sure that this development is going to impact it as much as we think as far as the mixed use. If it was all apartments or it's all, isn't it zoned commercial right now, Greg?
Yes, it is. That's correct. Regional Commerce 6.
Yeah. So to build right would be all commercial. And I'm really not in favor of that. I think the mixed use will help tap down a little bit on the traffic as well. But I can't reiterate enough about 96 in the future, but that's another discussion. Thank you.
Okay. Do we have a public comment on the line?
Any citizen comments on items 3 and 4 related to the rezoning and development plan for the Vintage at Watson Glen?
No comments.
Okay, we'll go.
We do have an email comment.
Okay, go ahead and read the email to us, please.
This is from R. Barry and Kathy Cullen. It says, if the issues raised in our email are accurate, increased density, public parking on Oak Meadows Drive, and the probable need for public utilities within the 10.25 acre site to be dedicated as a public park, why would FMPC and BOMA support these requests for rezoning and plan development when the majority of impacted communities are against these changes? Similar requests for rezoning and multifamily residential development were soundly defeated just a few years ago. This proposal is unquestionably inferior to the previous submission.
We'll now move on to item 5, which is the Parkland Construction and Dedication Agreement between the City of Franklin and Franklin Capital Investment for the property known as Vintage at Watson Glen PUD.
Yes, good evening. Greg touched on this a little bit in his earlier presentation, but they will be required to pay $1,054,484 in parkland impact fees. They are going to be constructing a private pool, which they will be able to offset 25% of that fee. And they will also be creating that public privately maintained park area, which will include some walking trails, disc golf, and some other gathering areas, and they will be eligible to receive up to a 75% offset for that amenity. Any questions?
Okay. Any questions from the board? Any public comments on item five?
Any callers online with public comment related to park land construction for the Watson Glen, vintage at Watson Glen PUD? Nothing, Mr. Mayor?
Well, item six, I think Mr. Gamble covered quite a bit of it, is the Vintage Oak Meadow Road impact fee agreement between the City of Franklin, Franklin Investment Holding. Any need to go into that anymore? Okay, we'll go to item seven, an ordinance to rezone 49.93 acres from Regional Commerce District to Plan District for the property located north of Meridian Boulevard and west of Carruthers Parkway, located at 9009.
Thank you.
Carruthers Parkway, East Works District, PUD subdivision, established a public hearing for July the 14th, 2020.
Thank you, Mayor. Yes, the applicant is requesting to rezone from Regional Commerce 12 to Plan District with the entitlements of 32.5 density, approximately 1.1 million square feet of office and commercial space, and 605 hotel keys. The development plan has been submitted concurrently with the rezoning request, and Envision Franklin places this parcel into the Regional Commerce design concept, which supports the rezoning. Staff recommends approval, and the Planning Commission recommended approval 8-0.
Okay, any comments from the board or questions?
I would just say that this is our first big redevelopment project with a sea of parking, asphalt parking, and it's breath of fresh air to know that we're going to get rid of the sea of asphalt parking over there and have a great redevelopment in our district here.
Thank you for those comments. Joy, I didn't mention the development plan, item number eight for the Eastworks District PUD subdivision.
We can jump on in that if that's okay with everyone.
Go ahead with that, and then whoever else wants to speak to it. I think Alderman Peterson had some comments maybe.
More on the development plan than this, so.
Let him discuss that, and then I'll come to you first, Alderman Peterson.
Okay, the full development plan, as well as my full staff report, are available to the board for you to review. I'll just hit the highlights and focus on the modification of standards, and I believe the applicant also wanted to say a few things as well. The plan as proposed for East Worth District meets many of the recommendations and guiding principles of Envision Franklin, especially for the regional design concept, regional commerce design concept. It eliminates existing surface parking lots by constructing new buildings with internal parking garages. The layout of the site allows for full fronted activation for most of the buildings. The proposed setbacks and street network promotes ground level activity and walkability for the entirety of the site. Multifamily buildings are a major component of the Eastworks District PUD with approximately 1,600 dwelling units. The plan proposes a cohesive development of urban living with a variety of ground floor retail and eatery options and office space that could serve as potential workspaces for residents of the district. The plan does incorporate some individual ground floor entrances for ground floor dwelling units as required by the zoning ordinance. However, they have submitted a modification of standards request for consolidated entrances at some locations. A parking study has been submitted with the development plan that analyzes needed parking for peak hours. The applicant has incorporated shared parking that will be phased throughout the construction of the site. The parking study calls for an approximate 40% reduction and was required by the zoning ordinance. For the modification of standards, and there is a modification of standards supplemental packet that the is part of your attachments as well, if you want to follow along. For the first modification, the applicant is requesting to allow consolidated entrances for ground floor multifamily dwelling units, citing topographical constraints, context, and market demand. That is not allowed by the zoning ordinance, which requires all ground floor apartments or dwelling units to have some sort of entrance to the street, not necessarily the main entrance, but a active entrance connected by a sidewalk or patio, that kind of thing, for every dwelling unit. So staff recommends disapproval of modification standard number one. The Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 6-2. For the second modification, the applicant is requesting to allow irregular shaped signs for hanging signs and wall signs, so that the sign itself can identify the subject business for that signage. So instead of geometric shapes like squares and rectangles, you see the tea kettle and the dog tag, that sort of thing. We just overhauled our sign ordinance section of the zoning ordinance. And we feel that is going against the purpose intent of those updated regulations and could set a precedent. So staff recommends disapproval for MOS number two. The Planning Commission recommended approval as presented by a vote of 6-2. For the third modification, the applicant is requesting to allow additional band signs, one band sign per tenant in addition to any allowed wall signage, which is not currently allowed in the zoning ordinance. However, due to the urban context of this development, staff can support the request of additional band signs of one per ground floor tenant in addition to allowed wall signs. Staff recommends approval of MOS number three, as did the Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 8-0. For MOS number four, the applicant is requesting to allow internal illumination for canopy signage, which is not allowed by the zoning ordinance. We again just overhauled our signage ordinance, and we feel that this may set precedent for requests outside of the development. So staff recommended disapproval of MOS number four, as well as the Planning Commission, which also recommended disapproval by a vote of 7-1. For MOS number five, the applicant is requesting to increase maximum size of hanging signs to 6 square feet and allow internal illumination. Currently, the zoning ordinance only allows a maximum of hanging signs of 3 square feet per side. They want to go up to 6 feet. And also, internal illumination is not allowed. Staff recommended disapproval of MOS number five. However, we do feel comfortable increasing the size to 4.5 square feet, which is currently permitted as a maximum size per side for the historic design guidelines. So what you see on Main Street, the stores along Main Street, they're allowed to go 4.5 square feet per side. The Planning Commission recommended approval of MOS with a maximum of 4.5 square feet per side and no external illumination by a vote of internal illumination, excuse me, by a vote of 8-0. MOS number six is to request allow one vertical blade sign per frontage in addition to allowed hanging signs for ground floor tenants. Currently, the zoning ordinance limits the number of vertical blade signs to one per building if no other hanging signs exist. So with the size and scale of the proposed development, one vertical blade sign per frontage in addition to allowed hanging signs for other tenants could be or would be appropriate. So as a condition of approval, the applicant will provide additional language to the modification request about allowed locations and only be allowed at intersection corners and building massing changes. So staff recommended approval with conditions for MOS number six, as did the Planning Commission recommended approval by a vote of 8-0. And for the seventh modification, the applicant is requesting to allow two wall signs located at the roof of the building in addition to the allowed band signs for the ground floor tenants. Currently, the zoning ordinance limits wall signs per building facade to only one per building facade if no band signs exist on the building. Two wall signs located at the roof line of a mixed use building limited to one per frontage could be supported in addition to the allowed band signs given the size and scale of the proposed development. As a condition of approval, the applicant will include in the final language that the MOS is limited to buildings of six stories or higher. So for MOS number seven, staff recommended approval with conditions, as did the Planning Commission recommended approval with conditions by a vote of 8-0. And a couple of overall project considerations I just wanted to run by real quick. For building height, the subject property, for the subject property, Appendix G of Envision Franklin places the portion of this parcel that fronts Carruthers Parkway in a maximum height of six stories. When the zoning map was updated as part of the 2019 zoning ordinance overhaul, it was placed into the Regional Commerce 12 zoning, which allows up to 12 stories by right. Additionally, that Appendix G shows the parcels to the south of the subject property within the 12-story max recommended for Carruthers. For these reasons, staff can support the proposed height range of 6 to 12 stories for the buildings that front Carruthers, despite the recommendations of Envision Franklin. If possible, taller buildings should be designed internal to the site. So with all of that in mind, the Planning Commission did recommend approval of the Eastworks development plan by a vote of 8-0, as did staff recommend approval of the Eastworks District PUD. I'm happy to go back and answer and clarify, because I know that was a lot of information. So I think Brian with the Eastworks applicants had also wanted to present something.
Sure, we'll give you about the same amount of time we gave Mr. Gamble earlier. So go ahead, Brian.
Thank you. Dirk, did you want to say a couple of things first?
No, just thank you everyone tonight for the opportunity to be here. We appreciate the time and understanding you have a pretty packed agenda this evening. I'm going to hand it straight over to Brian, and our whole team is here delighted to answer any questions you might have.
Great. So I'm going to share my screen very quickly, and we'll just run you through a couple of the MOS considerations here. And we have, you know, a whole presentation. So anything anybody wants to talk about, we can pull up slides to talk about, but I want to focus on the MOSs right now. In regard to the individual entrances versus what we're calling consolidated entrances, as Joey said, there are certain locations in the project that topographically warrant having a more consolidated entrance approach. But we've been, looking at some examples. I wanted to share some of these with you and sort of zoom in and so you can get an idea of, how a consolidated entrance can look. So you can see here an entrance in, you could go in, this could be, multiple units, a staircase or elevator. Here there's, it's not necessarily one entrance for the entire facade, but there's still multiple entrances, just not one for each unit on the ground floor. Here, looking sort of back historically, you see, this is done all over the place and, incredible, lovely apartment buildings. The scale and context of this is different than what we're talking about as far as this is more residential feeling, but you get the idea, one entrance, multiple units. This is a sort of a larger scale example where you can see consolidated entrances in a few of the different buildings that lead you up to the units. So it's, we definitely are in favor of the individual entrances very often in the project, but there are some cases where we want to be able to have the consolidated entrances. And here, this diagram shows where we're thinking about it. And what we want to do is have the individual entrances facing individual entrances. And so here, the orange represents individual entrances and the pink represents consolidated entrances. And because we have the existing Carruthers building, which is, not the most interesting building to look at, let's say, we thought that it might be a little bit more appropriate to have something that feels a little bit more urban in nature facing that building. And then also along the outer perimeter of the property, looking at having some consolidated entrances there. When it comes to the signage, this one in particular, the internal illumination, is something that wanted to share with you guys, looking at some additional precedent. I mean, you know, these are nice looking for sure. And we've added, you know, found some more images here for internally illuminated canopy signage, just to start to get a sense of what that would look like. Because it's not all just the sort of glowing letters from the inside out. It can also be internally illuminated in this way as well. When it comes to the hanging signs, internal illumination, here are some additional examples of that we wanted to share. We feel are quite nice and add a little bit more vitality in this more urban environment. But all of these signs have internal illumination, even this very thin one, which I thought was great. They have LED lights in them now instead of incandescent bulbs. And so the LED strips are very thin and allows the sign to essentially look like a blade sign, a regular blade sign or hanging sign in the daytime. And then at night they can come on and start to light it up. So here you can see actually a daytime shot of this sign, and this is the nighttime view of that sign as well. And even these very unique custom signs are internally lit as well. I think that was really
lost you, Brian.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, sorry. I was just saying, we've been before you so many times, we didn't want to spend the whole evening running you back through the project. But certainly if you have any questions, I have the full presentation on my slides here. We can pull up anything you want to go over.
Well, I'm going to go to Alderman Peterson now. And I will say that we will have public comments on 7 and 8, if there is anybody. We'll have those at the same time, but I'll open it up to the Alderman now. And so Alderman Peterson, and if anybody else, any of the other Aldermen wanting to make comments, text, you know, put it in the chat box.
Well, we're saying on the development part, there will be a public hearing also on it, not tonight, whenever we do the first hearing, but at the second reading, we'll have public comments. But just to say, mainly what the Planning Commission did agree with the request to have, not to have individual entrances onto the street all of the time. That was one where we agreed with the request, even though the staff recommended disapproval. But moving on down here, I think the very large percent, if not all, of the Planning Commission did not want to see the internal signs. That was pretty. Maybe there was one person who voted for one of them, but on those two, where the staff had recommended disapproval, we followed the staff recommendation there. We have talked over the years many times about needing external lighting on signs. I mean, like downtown and everything too. So just kind of hit those two highlights there were the things that I wanted to do. And again, they're all on modification standards. I think everyone is agreeing that the development plan as a whole is quite good.
Okay, I've got Alderman Berger followed by Alderman Speedy.
Thank you. I'm just gonna speak to two of them. I've been to every single meeting they've had. I've met with them and I attended the Planning Commission meeting as well. As far as modification standard one, the individual entrances, I get that, but it's really, you know, I think they're doing that with the townhomes, but they're needing a variety of entrances for the rentals. And I think that that's good because you want that element of security in those types of buildings. And you sort of want a central entrance. But in talking to them, as Brian showed along that one street, they'll have individual entrances on certain portions of it. So I like the fact that you've worked really well to
come up with options here and a variety rather than just strictly individual entrances or strictly consolidated entrances. I think that really appeals to people and they have an option. The sign shapes, you know, I totally supported that because, you know, we've got to be careful we don't become too vanilla. We're always talking about the character and the design of downtown. We beat that home all the time. Design, design, character, sense of place. Well, why not in Cool Springs? You know, we need to make sure in this redevelopment, we have a lot of different options and we have good design and we have the ability to have variety of designs. And so I thought if you go down to Buford, South Carolina to Buford itself or Habersham or go to some other, just pick other places, they have great signs and it adds to the development. And they're done tastefully done as well. The only other thing I really want to speak to, and I know the hanging signs will be spattered throughout, I mean, and used lightly. I mean, just because you get a modification standard doesn't mean they're going to do 20 or 40 hanging signs. You're going to have maybe two or three throughout the whole development. At least you get, gives you the option, again, to have character and design and not the sameness, not the vanilla that a development like this could end up being that I want to guard against. But the only other thing I really want to speak to, which really was sort of perplexing to me, that at the Planning Commission, not one person could give a good reason other than it was in our, Brian, you ought to pay attention to this because you helped write our ordinance. We need to change this. Not one good reason why anybody was really against internal lighting. Now, Anne had mentioned something about external lighting. Well, we have to be careful with our lighting today. We have great technology and we have LED lights and we have all sorts of lighting. And in the evening, if you, let's just take something everybody knows about. We have a Starbucks sign, looks very much like what's behind the mayor's head right there, the circle. And we have a Starbucks sign. Well, at night, I don't want a floodlight. I don't want other lighting shining up to that sign. If it's softly lit with soft light internally, which you all are talking about, that's a soft lit internal light. And that gives you, when you're walking down that sidewalk at night, you can see that sign. It's softly lit. It's nice on the eyes. It's not glaring. It's not intrusive. So that's one of the reasons I support canopy lighting, and I would vote for that modification standard. I think it's really important that we get things like our redevelopment right. I certainly don't want these outside internal external lights going on, but the internal soft light that we have today, you have great options today to pull from. And the illumination is so much different with the technology. So I fight against vanilla. I want to see variety. I want to see this come to this development. And so those were the two that I really thought, I agreed with all the modification standards because I thought they had a good variety here and it, you had it well planned. Thank you.
Alderman Speedy.
Well, my question would be, it's my understanding that the illuminated signs would only be probably in the interior of the development. And then my next question is, I'm assuming we're talking about a sign similar to the Franklin Theater sign on Main Street. And if so, to me, that's kind of part of the iconic reason or most photographed parts of our downtown Main Street. So would that be a sign that I guess now that wouldn't be allowed under our zoning ordinance?
No, the marquee was approved based on its historical presence back in the 40s or 50s, whenever it was installed.
Mr. Mayor, since Scott's speaking to that, could the applicant put that internal light sign up that had the, Brian, do you have that one that says hotel on it? I thought, because the marquee, Scott, you bring up a great point, but that marquee down there is sort of huge and stuff. And I think this is so much smaller scale, very small scale. I'm just curious, since you asked that question, if we could look at it.
Yeah, like the Mont Vale.
Yeah, I think if I remember correctly, there is a marquee sign type in the ordinance as well. That's essentially that would fall under, that the Franklin Theater would fall under, but maybe like Gray's, for instance, would be another example of one. And those are technically, you know, neon. I think the point is still, you're well taken, that, you know, it's not lights pointing down onto a sign that are lighting it. The sign is itself lit, and it is iconic.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's talking neon here. We're talking internally. As we said, technology's given us great options today, especially with LED lighting.
Do we have anybody on the phone, Mr. Stuckey?
Any citizens calling in related to the Eastworks proposed development plan? Nothing, Mr. Mayor.
If it's fine with the group, we'll move on to item 9. City of Franklin contract 2020-0132, Parkland Impact Fee Construction Dedication Agreement between the City of Franklin and Market Street Management LLC for the property known as Eastworks District.
Yes, thank you. So they are going to be paying a total Parkland Impact Fee of $6,989,696. This is our first agreement coming in after we passed our amendments. So they will actually be paying 25% of the total Parkland impact fee obligation at the recording of the first final plat or the issuance of the first building permit when a plat is not required for any property that includes a structure with dwelling units. And then the remaining 75% of that obligation will be paid on a prorated per permit basis for dwelling unit permits. They do have several pools that they are going to be constructing, as well as a central park area in the plan, and they will be eligible to receive an offset up to 50% since those are going to be private amenities. And I'm happy to answer any questions if anyone has any.
Okay, we'll move on to item number. Well, are there any public comments on that, Mr. Stuckey?
Any comments
on Parkland dedication? Item 10, consideration of draft City of Franklin contract number 2020-0135, Eastworks District Road Impact Offset Agreement between the City of Franklin and Market Street Management LLC. I see movement, but I don't hear Mr. Holson. Is Paul's trying to speak?
Here, but we don't see. Can you hear me now?
We can hear you now.
Oh, have at it. Thank you. I'm not sure what I did there differently, but it's working. So if you remember, we went through these impacts early on as we noticed that some of the intersections were failing with the Board of Mayor and Alderman. And at that point in time, we decided to take on the bigger Cool Springs Transportation Study to look at development holistically throughout the Cool Springs area. And so at the time, the direction was to continue to proceed with the development. And the Board of Mayor and Alderman very much wanted to proceed with it as is. And so we've gone that route. I'll say that our traffic engineer, Adam Mosier, and city staff has worked with the consulting team to try to mitigate as many of the impacts as possible. And I will walk you through those improvements as shown. So the first exhibit that I'm showing right here is Carruthers Parkway at Baker's Bridge. We'll be adding on Baker's Bridge a double left turn lane. We'll also be adding here on the southbound approach of Carruthers Parkway, an additional right turn lane. We'll be adding an additional right turn lane and reconfiguring the pavement markings here on the westbound approach as well. And this is again at the intersection of Carruthers Parkway and Baker's Bridge. Moving to the next intersection is Carruthers Parkway and Cool Springs Boulevard. This is one of those intersections where there still are failures during those peak hours. But again, we've done everything in our power to try to mitigate those. I also have to say that a lot of the failures were happening simply with background growth associated with other development along this corridor. It's not all simply related to Eastworks. But the improvements that we're planning to make here is adding a triple left turn lane here on Carruthers Parkway northbound, which will get you on to the I-65 northbound ramp with this dedicated right turn lane. We're looking to make here on Cool Springs Boulevard this a through right and adding a right turn lane. And on the eastbound approach, adding a double right with a through lane at Carruthers Parkway and Cool Springs Boulevard. I will say this is one of the intersections that's critical and is it is approaching failures, but again, we went through that a few months back with the Board of Mayor and Aldermen. So with the triple turns in Cool Springs Boulevard, we're looking to add additional space to eliminate weaving, possible weaving movements and the safety associated with weaving movements. And so for this on-ramp here, we're looking to shift this as far west as possible. And it will ultimately be signalized with the improvements, laneage configuration improvements that you see here to get a double left turn onto the ramp. And this will actually be, you can't really see it, there'll be a through lane, a shared through right lane, and a right lane here at the interchange. The last improvement is as you get on southbound onto I-65, looking to make a double left turn lane at the interchange to again go southbound on I-65 ramp. That is a summary of the improvements. I will make one correction. The impact fee agreement that you have in front of you is in a draft format. And so the impact fees that we had estimated with this have changed slightly, and that's because our estimates are getting finalized. And so the eligible arterial road impact fee reimbursement is estimated at this point to be around $8.26 million on the arterial roads. And for the collectors, it's estimated to be around $660,000 for the improvements that they're making. That's essentially Baker's Bridge. And so that will be corrected as this proceeds forward to the board. It was just initially brought forward with a rough draft. And again, we've been able to fine tune those estimates working with the development team since the Planning Commission meeting. So with that said, I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have about the traffic associated with this project and the impact fee agreement.
Any questions from the board?
I have a quick question for Paul. Paul and Dirks, whoever's on. So this is pretty extensive. I really like that you're doing this up there at the interstate because it's a huge need. This project's a 12 to 15 year project. So where does this all come into play in relative to the schedule for doing I-65, the intersection of Cool Springs and the Baker's Bridge, and then of course you got your turn lanes and everything, but how does that play in with the schedule?
So, and Dirk's welcome to chime in, but generally speaking, we try to pair the payment of impact fees up and match those with the most appropriate improvement and prioritize those. You know, generally speaking, we're going to want to see the worst intersections improve, or we're going to want to work from the interstate ramps back towards the development. And so it's a multi-year project, and generally speaking, we try to pair the improvements to happen either as the frontage improves or as the impact fees are paid in, we proceed with those projects.
Yeah, I agree. Paul and his staff have done a tremendous job really prioritizing for the community the areas where the project can have the most potential benefit at the earliest opportunity. We're completely supportive of what they've come up with.
I think one of your earliest opportunities for impact, well, as you do develop, would be the I-65 corridor, because regardless of what's happening internally to your site, it's going to take years. So, critical. Thank you.
Okay. Any other comments from the board? Any other comments from the board, Mr. Stuckey? Anybody on the line?
Any citizen comments on the phone line related to the road impact fee agreement for the Eastworks project? Nothing, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, we'll now go to item 11, which is a third party administrator services City of Franklin contract 2020-0120 for City of Franklin self-insured workman's comp. We'll also consider item 12, which is a surety bond issued required by the state of Tennessee for this.
You'll remember, Mayor, we talked about this probably a year ago when we were looking at budget development, went through process of looking at bringing on a third party administrator to help us do a self-insured workers' compensation program.
And it aligns best to do it with the onset of a new fiscal year. So that's what we're lined up to do heading into fiscal 21. Kevin Townsend's on the line. This both provides us with the TPA services and establishes a necessary surety bond to help us run the program. So Kevin, I'll let you add anything you'd like.
PMA Management Corporation, they'll be our third party administrator to and we partner with them because they're the perfect vendor that help us continue the same sort of way we take care of our employees. They understand that we want our employees to maintain a high level of service if they get injured. So that's what this agreement's about, is partnering with PMA Management Corporation. And to do so, as you mentioned, Mayor, we have to have a surety bond issued, and that's why that next item is there. It's the $500,000 surety bond, which costs $10,000.
And you'll remember from the financial analysis of this option that we thought over time we'll have the opportunity to probably save some money by self-insuring. There may be a few years where it costs us a little more, but as a whole, we feel we can run it more effectively. And as Kevin said, by having the right partner, still make sure we're providing the high level of service and care to any of our employees that might get hurt on the job. Of course, we do a lot of work up front to prevent those kind of injuries and have a very dedicated team within risk management, especially throughout all our departments to help work on that as well. But I think this is a good opportunity for us over time to save some dollars, but continue to take good care of our people.
Any comments? Anybody on the phone, Mr. Stuckey?
Any comments regarding the two items related to self-insured workers' compensation program? Nothing, Mr. Mayor?
We'll go on to item 13, resolution to award the 2020 on-call annual contract for asphalt work to Four Star Paving.
Yes, so good evening, Mr. Mayor. So this is our annual on-call contract for resurfacing city streets out of the State Street Aid Fund. We feel like we received very competitive bids for this process, and upon reviewing the bid tabs, staff recommends awarding the contract to the lowest qualified bidder, Four Star Paving, LLC.
Let me just touch on this a little bit. I shared with the board an email I received last night, shared with you this morning, from Alderman Blanton, just expressing some of her concerns regarding the bid. Related to one of her comments, but also just a clarification as you look at the material on this bid award, what we did is we broke it into a unit cost. So there's a $2,000 difference in the bids, but it's per unit. So what I asked staff to look at is if you look at the work we did last year in this same area, that unit cost would translate into an annual cost difference or savings between low bidder and next low bidder of about $230,000 a year. So it is not just a $2,000 difference. You have to apply it over the amount of paving that would likely take place in a year, and it's somewhere in that $230,000 range. Of course, it'll vary a little bit on the quantities or the amount of work we do, but this is a good value. It's actually a significant reduction over what we're currently paying. The market has helped us here in terms of the cost, I believe, of the asphalt. And so this is a positive for us to be able to get more work done efficiently and help, especially our neighborhood streets.
I have a question.
Go ahead, Alderman Martin. Unmute. Alderman.
All right. When the bids went out for the applicants, was it noted that it was going to be more than $2,000? Was it going to be $230,000 or just $2,000? I mean, did the applicants know that when they made their offer?
So, Alderman Martin, when the contracts go out, because it's so competitive and complicated, typically we use a square yardage, a cubic yard, a lane mile, tonnage. You kind of throw all that in. And so the applicant or the contractor has to bid on all those items individually. So we kind of give them a range of 1 to 9. So we make it as competitive as possible. And so there's not a number of 230 or 2000.
Yeah, and what we provided you with is a summary. We combined those costs to give you a comparison into a unit cost, but all of the bidders have the same information around the potential amount of work, and they put their best pricing forward. What we've given you is a summary, and our streets team put it together working with engineering to try to give you a summary cost amount and by unit, and hopefully that helps. But it's a competitive bidding. They all had the same information around the quantity of work, the type of the work. I believe they were very familiar with it and gave us their best pricing.
So, in other words, the $230,000 is what we came up with. Yes. After we looked at the year's work.
Right, and that's actually a number I asked staff to give you because I felt like the unit pricing might not resonate with you. So I said, take the work that we did in the most recent year, and what would that mean in terms of a cost difference between the lowest two bidders? And so that $230,000 is a calculation based on last year's work. What would the difference have been in the cost between the two bidders? So it's just to give you a sense of the difference applied to a typical year of work.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Go ahead, Alderman Barnhill.
In reference to Alderman Blanton's email, one of the things that she questioned, one of the things that we've been questioned, is the quality of work versus the applicant one, applicant two. And when I looked at it, it was $2,000 difference in the contract, not $230,000 difference. So addressing that, address the quality of work and address the difference between the two, because if I looked at her email somewhat, that there was a paragraph or a sentence or two in there in reference to that. But if we're not getting satisfactory service or whatever, we need to look at that rather than trying to go back to the same vendor hoping to save $2,000 or $231,000, whatever it is. So we need to look at the quality between the two and or the quality of the first bidder, who happens to be the low bidder, and just address some of the issues there.
Steve, you want to address that?
Yes, sir. So staff evaluated projects, and fortunately we've had a long history with the second low bidder, as well, over 20 years of experience with them. And we've only had a couple years with the currently lowest qualified bidder who actually currently does our paving for us in 2020. And in grading those two, we would give both of those groups an A minus to a B plus rating in the type of work that they turn out. And a perfect example of that is Royal Oaks Boulevard and Mallory Lane. There's about a year and a half difference in the paving, and you can drive both of those projects, and you'd see that there's not a lot of difference in the quality of work that you're going to see by the eye. And so in our professional opinion, certainly the lowest qualified bidder is capable of doing the work that we desire.
Mr. Mayor, I have a question or comment. This is Bev. Good.
Go ahead.
All right. We'll do thumbs up.
Go Steve, ahead, Alderman Berger.
We can just do this. Steve, are you there?
I am.
Yeah. So I was trying to drive around, look at this. I had to be out this afternoon, so I tried to look. But did the lowest bidder do Liberty Pike last year?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, that was excellent. I have gotten so many compliments on the job that was done. So I was just curious if there was any areas that were done that you were not extremely happy with, or you think was done under par.
Well, I will say that the Mallory Lane project out of between McEwen Drive and Moore's Lane, there's a couple areas on that stretch of roadway that we weren't just ecstatic over. They were short sections of pavement. It wasn't the overall project. And what we've done is we recommended actually in-house to do nighttime work. Well, nighttime work is always going to impact the quality of work that we get, but the offset is that the motoring public is not impacted by performing nighttime work. And so we made that decision in-house, and so we kind of had to live with the results. So I think that it would have been overall much better product had it been daytime, but the public would not have been happy with us in the Cool Springs area.
Okay, so let me just say two things. Number one, if there's areas that were not sufficiently done and we have problems with them, we need to have something in the contract that has them go back and fix those sections, because I don't want to see a heavily traveled road, that Mallory is such a heavily traveled road that is going to have problems where we paid to have that done and it's not sufficient. That's number one. Number two, I would highly recommend if we see a difference in quality from the daytime to the nighttime, that we, and even though it's, I think, you know, your high traveled roads, you want them to do that at night. But if it impedes the quality, I mean, how about all these other people that bid? Would it impede their quality? I don't know. I'm not into that business, so I don't know. You have to tell me. But if that's the case, then maybe we inconvenience people during the day, so we get better quality work. I mean, I'll just throw that out to you to think about.
That is certainly part of our evaluation. Yes, ma'am.
And that's really not an issue around a single vendor. That's a decision and a trade-off you look at in terms of inconvenience versus how it works and getting the project done effectively and the quality at the end of it. So that's something we continue to look at.
Yeah, and I would say let's inconvenience people if we have to have the quality. I mean, side roads and things are different, but I know heavily traveled areas is, you know, we definitely want to do it at night because we don't want to inconvenience the people, but I would rather take the quality over inconveniencing the people.
Mr. Mayor.
Alderman Bransford.
Yeah, I just want to make sure as we have this conversation, regardless of which one is chosen officially, is that we have in a contract, because if we have crumbling asphalt as within months or weeks of a project, I think that company should come back. And I think, Shana, is that incorporated in the contract in some way, or do we just live with what we get once they have paved over a road? How much guarantee, for lack of a better word, since they both A minuses and B pluses. So I think we will have some issue with both groups, but if they're using less oil and less rocks and less whatever that makes it a good product, then that's something that they're gonna have to be accountable for. Can you talk about how we can hold either one of them accountable for a certain period of time? We know they're gonna be wear and tear, but a certain time. I know there was some work done somewhere, maybe the private resident off Hillsborough Road, but within weeks, the products were really, really not sufficient. Okay, just talk a little bit about that.
Yes, I can address that. So we actually do have a warranty period, and the contractors is responsible for any poor workmanship that we investigate and deem that needs to be repaired immediately. And that's supposed to be done at our request and certainly within the year of the contract. And we do have quality control inspectors on site during every paving project that look after the quality of the workmanship being done.
Thank you, that's good to know.
Okay, let's go to item 14. On-call contract for pavement preservation to Pavement Restorations, Inc. Any questions about that one? Anybody on the phone about either one of those on-calls, Mr. Stuckey?
Any citizen comments related to items 13 and 14, on-call contract for paving and pavement restoration?
Seeing none, we'll go on to item 15, draft resolution 2020-103, a resolution approving and authorizing the city administrator to pay the contractor an additional bonus for early completion of the Franklin Road Improvements Project.
Yes, Mr. Mayor and Board, we had talked a little bit about this, I think within the last year, and we're getting ready at your next meeting to award the bid for Franklin Road construction. We're excited to move that project forward. One of the concepts that we had brought up to the board and as an option for us is to go ahead and have an incentive in place that you would authorize the city administrator to make an incentive if the contractor is able to deliver the project with no excuses by a date certain. This wouldn't be subject to weather delays or any of the other topics that sometimes come up around change orders. It would be a hard and fast, if you deliver it by a specific date identified as the incentive date, there would be a financial reward for reaching that. And the thought is that provides the benefit to lessening the disruption and inconvenience to the community. And there's also issues, or it helps us avoid some other costs for an extended period of time in terms of the construction period. I just saw a note. Are you all hearing me okay, or is it cutting in and out? Okay. All right. That's really the overview. I'll let Paul kind of talk through the more specific structure that we're proposing. Staff's thought a lot about it. We've tried to be creative in something that would be beneficial overall and get the attention of a contractor to really have them prioritize the project and its completion, timely completion in this incentive structure. So Paul, take it away.
Okay, thank you, Eric. So over the past few years, there's been a lot of discussion internally about what we can do to ensure delivery of capital projects. And so we worked really hard with our law department, revising our contract, defining what substantial completion is, defining what is allowable for a weather delay, because oftentimes you end up getting into arguments about those items. And so we have reworked a lot of our contract language over the past few years to better accommodate that and encourage the contractor to get done. So in our current contracts right now, we basically have a contract deadline, and I'm going to use Franklin Road as an example, is that they have 2 years to get substantial completion, which is very well defined as far as having pavement, you know, open, the entire job seated, sodded, et cetera, having all the utilities in, no more than 2.5% of the contract remaining. And we've really, really honed in on the legal language. If they fail to meet the substantial completion deadline, again, as Franklin wrote as the example, they'll face $2,000 per day liquidated damages, which are there to cover our costs associated with management of the project. We also have then substantial completion. We also have a final completion. They have a 60 days after substantial to get to final completion, which is essentially punch list items. And talking with Vernon, he's made it very clear that punch list should be less than a page long. It's a punch list. It should be pretty much complete. And so we've, again, continued to discuss that. If they don't meet the final completion deadline, again, additional liquidated damages kick in to cover a lot of our administrative costs associated with the project. And that for Franklin Road, again, is set at $2,000 per day. The other item we've included in our contract is an incentive to encourage contractors to get done. Don't just decentivize them, also offer an incentive. And so for the Franklin Road project right now in the contract, there's an incentive of $2,000 per day, the same as the liquidated damages, which again covers our administrative costs, with a maximum amount not to exceed $100,000. We generally will always put in that maximum amount not to exceed to encourage that contractor to get done, but also set a threshold. So also thinking outside the box, what are some other items we can do to try to encourage contractors to get these jobs done on time, under budget, and truly we want them done in advance of the schedule. And so what we've talked about doing is offering a no excuse incentive on the Franklin Road project, meaning weather delays do not factor in, utility delays would not factor in. We've defined it in the resolution, very similar to our substantial completion definition of lanes open, signals operational, all utilities in place, services in place, and really try to encourage the contractor to get done well before the schedule. And so what we're proposing is with this no excuse incentive is offering one or the other. If they can get the job completed in 615 days, we would offer an additional incentive of $150,000, which would be on top of the contract incentive of $100,000. So if they got it done in 615 days, they would essentially, and they meet all of our requirements, they would essentially get a bonus of $250,000. We even went as far as saying, you know, if the contractor really puts forth the effort, puts multiple crews on the site, works in advance to try to get these utilities relocated, that there's a chance they could get this job done in 18 months based on the projected notice to proceed that we're going to issue. And so what we're recommending is a no excuse incentive that if they can get it done in 550 calendar days, which is essentially, again, about 18 months, they could get an additional incentive of $400,000, which would be a total of $500,000 when you add the $100,000 into that's already written into the contract. So this resolution is essentially giving authority to our city administrator to further incentivize the contractor to get the job done well before the contract deadlines. And again, we've tried in the resolution to define what that completion is, substantial completion, and have it very well defined to make it as black and white as possible as to whether they receive and get this incentive or not. So hopefully that makes sense. At this point, we're just trying to see feedback from the board. Again, the D incentive on this project is $2,000 per day if they don't meet substantial or final completion. There's also currently a $2,000 per day capped at $100,000 incentive in the contract today. It's just a question of whether once we award this, do you want to further incentivize the low bid contractor to try to get this work done in a timely manner?
So we welcome some feedback. It is a different approach. It is different than what we have done in terms of providing kind of a carrot and an incentive to get it done, because one of our focuses have been delivering capital projects. This is a different way to try to get them done in a more timely manner. We welcome your feedback on this approach.
Mayor, I have a question.
Go ahead, Alderman Martin, and let me preface this by saying that Franklin Road came in significantly under what originally we thought it was going to cost. Go ahead, Alderman Martin.
I'm thrilled at this news. I think it's wonderful. But we just want to be sure that it's done well and not just so fast that they get the money. I'm sure that we will be inspecting it. I will be inspecting it too. But I think it's a wonderful idea. Give them as much money as you can, but it must be done well.
You're out there inspecting. They better be afraid. Anybody else want to make any comments? I see Alderman Barnhill.
Yeah.
And then Alderman Bransford after that.
Mayor, I don't have any comments at this time. I cannot top Margaret's inspection, so I'll just defer to someone else on the board.
Alderman Bransford.
Well, my comment is that that's significantly underbidding on a bid that we got worries me a little bit. So I'm really appreciative that we have some safeguards that we're trying to create here and some incentive for things to go forward in a good way. So I'm going to be a little skeptical for now on that little bid. Thank you.
Alderman Berger?
Yes.
You
thank you. Paul? Are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
We had that discussion about the roundabout. Sorry to bring that sort of subject up, but do we have anything in this contract that says that the company that we hire can't outsource this to a certain extent, that then we're not in control again? We have subcontractors not doing their job or hard to deal with. So we were talking about before possibly that limiting a company that we hired to 25% of outsourcing. So what do you want to say about that here?
So yes, we did have language to that nature in the bid. I'll say that the bids came in significantly under of what we had budgeted, but the bids were very close to what we had estimated when we got to the point of final quantities. Both contractors who bid the project were very close with their bids and both planned to perform the majority well over 20% of the work themselves. And so that is not the case as it was with the roundabout, where the majority of the work was done by a subcontractor. So we have addressed that in this bid and we continue to address that with future bids moving forward.
Okay, but you just said 20%. If they do 20%, that's not the majority.
No, Civil Constructors is doing well over 20%. They're doing all the utility work, all the grade work. They're subbing out very little. And the same with the other prime contractor that bid that didn't win. The prime contractor is doing almost all of the work that they possibly can on their own.
Well, 20%. So they have multiple subcontractors then for all these different things?
No, they're doing well over the 20%. And I'm sorry if I misspoke there. They're doing well over the 20%. I don't have the exact amount. They're subbing out some of the specialty electrical work. They're subbing out some of the signal work. And some of the concrete work.
Well, when I look at something, I see 100% project. And if somebody's doing 20%, who's doing the other 80?
Yeah, they're doing well over the 20%.
Okay, we'll talk about that later because that's not computing. And they're doing 20, they should be doing 80.
Alderman Berger, he didn't say 20%. If he said that, he misspoke.
Yeah.
You're pointing in on the 20%. It's not 20%. It's a far more than that.
All right. So as long as they're doing the majority. Okay, got it.
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
Alderman Peterson.
I just wanted to know what other governments are doing anything like this. I mean, you don't have to answer me now, but I just like to know about some people, some other municipalities or whatever that have used this idea for the incentive and how it's gone for them. As I say, don't need to know now, but just will be curious about that.
Yeah, we can provide you some information. Actually, Shauna just sent us something about some work in Shelby County and also some TDOT work that might relate to some incentives. So we'll share some of that with you. We need to process it a little more.
Anybody on the phone?
Any comments on the incentive for early completion of Franklin Road? Nothing, Mr. Mayor?
Item 16, a resolution declaring the city will accept community development block grant coronavirus funds from the Department of Housing and Urban Development.
As we shared with you when we talked to some about our coronavirus response, the federal government through the CDBG
program has provided entitlement communities like Franklin some funds. And in our case, it's about $213,000. So Kathleen Cecid has worked with that and worked with outreach to local nonprofits. That's where we decided to target those dollars, that would be a good place to put some resources towards folks who have stepped up in that sector. And I'll let Kathleen walk through that.
Thank you, Eric. Well, I reached out, as Eric said, the mayor was sent a letter that awarded us this $213,789, which is above and beyond our CDBG funds. However, the funds have to be used for the prevention of COVID care or it must be used. We have to partner with local agencies to prevent anything dealing with COVID care. I reached out to the United Way, as well as our independent nonprofits, to see what they have done to date, because this is the reimbursable project only. They were very kind in sending me where they stand today with funds that they have spent. And we are just waiting to hear from IDIS to make sure the funds get put into our account. I did have to amend the 2019 annual action plan to reflect this amount. The amendment is complete. I'm waiting to hear back from HUD on approval of the amendment to include these funds. We did have to hold a public hearing. It was we only had to do it for 5 days. We did it via, I did a outreach through United Way, as well as all of our local nonprofits. And we also posted on Facebook. So if you have any questions, I'm available to answer.
I have a question. Sure. So you mentioned that it can only be used to prevent COVID. I don't know how you spend $213,000. What kinds of things are we talking about?
Well, if you look at the table that was attached, it was buying PPE. Some of the nonprofits bought their PPE. Some of them had to put people up in hotels that had been out on the streets. Bridges actually had to switch to disposable dishes because they were housing so many people. They moved to disposable dishware. The Boys and Girls Club, they ended up having to hire more staff to accommodate the children that were getting dropped, because the parents were going into work. Food.
So in other words, are we reimbursing now?
Good evening. This is Tom Mars, and just to clarify, the funds are for to prevent, prepare for, and or respond to the coronavirus outbreak. And you're correct, Alderman Berger, as with all of our CDBG funds, it's paid on a reimbursement basis. So as was shown in the staff report, one of the other things that will come, as you're familiar with CDBG contracts, there will be a contract that comes to you with each agency where they will also, in order to be reimbursed, they would present an invoice and a receipt for expenses they have already incurred, and then we would reimburse them.
Okay, so some of the things that Kathleen just mentioned, things of that nature.
Correct.
All right, so in other words, the expenses they've had to put out to address this, then they would be getting reimbursed through some of these funds. Okay. I was wondering how that worked.
Okay. I just have a comment about, just for example, the community housing for, well, not community housing, but community child care. If they had to purchase more Clorox wipes or more disposable, as you mentioned, Kathleen, then they can invoice that through your, through this program, correct?
Correct.
Yep. They have more students because their parents, more children, babies, young people, because their parents, and one, had to go into these required jobs, you know, whether it was Kroger or stocking shelves at Walmart or something like that. So these, they can reimburse and get money for that?
Yes, ma'am. They will prepare an invoice, and I am going to go on the assumption that most of these funds have already been spent, because when this went out, we had a, we have a good relationship with our nonprofits. And yes, so I'm going to use the community healthcare, the masks that they had to buy, the gloves that they had to buy, the additional food that they used. They've already expended those funds. We are just looking to reimburse them. They'll present an invoice with the total amount with documented receipts. Once the funds are put into our account, we can reimburse that dollar for dollar until this fund is depleted. And the suggested table is what they in turn sent to us. So I created the table from the request that I received.
I like to think that there's several nonprofits that will not be expected in a reimbursement. They was doing it, they're just doing it because they had the funds or the equipment or whatever to do it with. What about the public health department? Is that, would that be considered if they gave out masks or gave services to the citizen? Would the public health department be considered a recipient, or will they be getting their own maybe set of monies?
I think I'll defer to Eric on that.
Yeah. That's a good question. I think that is a separate avenue. And we
targeted nonprofits. That's really a governmental entity. And there have been resources that are more targeted directly towards local and governmental efforts. So I think it's a different grouping of support from the federal government.
Has money coming to them, and it's coming, I guess, and,
in fact, we had one or two nonprofits look at this program and decide they were
served by going through another avenue and decided not to pursue the CDBG because they may be able to get more reimbursement in another place, and of course didn't want to submit in two different programs. They wanted to just focus in the one that was the best fit.
Thank you. That's helpful.
Anybody on the phone there?
Any citizen comment on the line related to the CDBG COVID funding? Nothing, Mr. Mayor.
Which is draft procurement award to Garney Companies, Inc. of Nashville, Tennessee, in the amount of $2,615,635 for Spencer Creek Sanitary Sewer Interceptor Rehabilitation Project for the Wastewater General Division of the Water Management Department. Any questions about that one? Okay, we'll conclude this work session and we'll be back in about 10 minutes. Stay tuned.